Now, the best way to test this is going to be with the key switch off and the batteries disconnected. So now that we've made our voltage checks, let's turn the key switch off, disconnect our batteries, then we're going to go across pins C and D, check our resistance, and we're hoping for 60 ohms plus or minus 2. Hey everybody, I'm Scott Meek, manager of Diesel Training. I've had a couple people reach out to me lately and say that they've had some communication issues and they weren't sure if it was a computer problem or a truck problem. So what I wanted to do really quick is put together a tech tip video that can show you a few simple steps that can show you if it is a truck problem. Now, before we get too far into this, if you like what we've been doing and you've been enjoying our tech tip videos, please remember to like, subscribe to the channel, and please throw some comments down below of things that you think about what we're doing or maybe some things you want to see. Now, back to the task at hand. What we want to do anytime we have a computer communication issue, so for an example, I'm trying to hook my diagnostic laptop up to my vehicle to pull fault codes, something simple like that. And let's say we're not able to communicate. Well, there's a few things we need to check, and oftentimes those things are going to be located at the 9-pin connector. Now, I'm specifically talking about a 9-pin today, but we can do other connectors in the future. Now, with your standard 9-pin diagnostic connector, you're going to have 9 pins or 9 terminal locations. There are some that are more important than others, especially when it comes to communicating on a public data bus. So let's do some really quick troubleshooting to figure out, is our vehicle outputting what we expect so our computer can communicate properly? So the first question I'll ask you is, when you plug in your diagnostic communication cable, does the box itself light up? If it doesn't, then you likely have a power supply or ground issue at your 9-pin. So we want to start with those to make sure that the box has sufficient power to power up so we can communicate. Now, a couple tools I'll use. I'm going to use this, keep it very simple. I'm going to use a digital multimeter. And those of you that know me know that I like to have a hands-free operation. In other words, what I like to do is take banana clips and use terminals or test lead-ins that I can use, connect to the terminal, and then that way I don't have to worry about, you know, my test lead wiggling around or not getting a good reading. Another thing that does is allow me to be hands-free so I can do the measurement and let go of all my tooling. So in this case, I just have a couple banana clip ends on my leads. I have a couple of terminal leads here that I'm going to use for the 9-pin connector. These are just standard little circular leads. And then I'm going to use a alligator clamp for ground sourcing. So to get started, when we look at our 9-pin connector, you're going to have 9 pins. The 2 pins that supply power and ground to your communication box is going to be pins A and pins B. Now, most of the time, on most manufacturers, with the exception of Caterpillar, you're going to have ground on pin A and power or voltage on pin B. Typically, the voltage on pin B will be battery supplied, not ignition. Although, if you don't have battery power, turn the ignition on just to make sure. So we're going to take our multimeter. We're going to put it on the voltage DC setting. We're going to install our leads here so we can have that hands-free operation. And then I'm going to connect one of these leads to pin A, the other lead to pin B. Now, pin A is the very center pin, very quick to find. Once I've done that, I'm now going to take the other side and go to pin B. Now, once I do that, I should have battery voltage. Now, my batteries are a little discharged, but you can see here that I have 12.21 volts. So if I have roughly 12 volts across terminals A and B, then my voltage should be sufficient to power up my communication device, whether that's a Nexic device, whether that's a TXT, or a JALTEST V9, whatever adapter you're using, that's the power supplied to the communication box to turn it on. So that's sufficient. So I know my box should be powered. Now, the next step that I want to take is I want to check pins C and pins D. Typically, on a 9-pin connector, that is going to be considered CAN channel 1. So in today's vehicles with 9-pin, you should have CAN high and CAN low on pins C and D. Remember, CAN low will be roughly 2.4 volts, and CAN high will be roughly 2.6 volts. Now, I'm going to leave my center pin on pin A where it's at now, because that's our ground. So now that we know we have a good ground, I'm going to leave that there and use that as my ground source. However, I'm going to move pin B, the terminal, from pin B to pin C. Now, once I do that, you'll notice here I have roughly 2.6 volts. Now, that's telling me that my can high is within its threshold. It doesn't mean that it's perfect, but it lets me know that my voltage is what I should expect. Now, once I've done that, I'm going to leave pin A where it's at because that's a ground source, and I'm going to move my terminal from pin C to pin D. Once I've done that, you'll notice that I have roughly 2.3, almost 2.4 volts. So that's telling me that my can high and can low are both in the expected voltage range. So that's telling me that my bus is functioning the way I should expect, at least on the static voltage readings. Now, that's only four of the nine pins. Those are the primary pins you're going to be utilizing: power, ground, can high, and can low. Now, if we go to pin E would be considered a shielding pin. Most manufacturers aren't going to put anything on pin E, but if they did, that would just simply be a shield. There's really nothing to test there theoretically in our field. Now, once we leave pin E, then we have pin F and G. Now, pin F and G is going to be channel 2. Typically, on your heavy-duty trucks, channel 2, or pins F and G, are typically going to be 1708 communication, okay? So in that case, I'm going to remain on pin A for my ground source, but I'm going to move from pin D to pin F. Now, when I do that, you'll see that I have roughly 3.4 volts, okay? Typically, what you want to see with 1708 is 4 volts on one wire, 1 volt on the other. Here, I've got 3.4 to 3, it's actually showing 3.8 volts now. So I've got close to that 4 volt on pin F. Now I'm going to move from pin F to pin G. Once I've done that, you'll see I have 1 volt. So I've got 3.8 volts on one side of the 1708, and I've got 1 volt on the other side of the 1708, or very close to. Remember, these values will fluctuate slightly as you're connected to them. Now, that's telling me that my 1708 bus is close to what I expect in terms of voltage readings. So can high was 2.6, can low was 2.4, and then on my 1708 bus, my 1708 positive is roughly 4 volts, my 1708 negative is roughly 1 volt. Now, that leads us with two pins remaining. Those are going to be pins H and J. Now, H and J are typically what they call OEM specific, and what that means is this: the OEM can determine what they want to put there. It's a free-for-all. So sometimes you'll see things like K-line bus. You may see another set of can channels on pins H and J. So if you have another set of can, you would have 2.6 and 2.4 is there as well. You could have another 1708 bus. There's a lot of different options that they have there. Most times, when you're trying to communicate to a vehicle for troubleshooting, those two terminals generally aren't going to be necessary, but there will be circumstances where they are, such as PACCAR products. So they use a second can channel on pins H and J. So you should again have 2.6 and 2.4. Now, one last thing that we want to do to verify that our bus is working the way we expect, because we just checked the voltages and the voltages are present, now we want to check the resistance of our bus. So typically, when we're checking resistance of our bus, we're going to go across pin C and pin D, which is going to be our channel 1. In this case, and in most cases, that's going to be 1939, or can, and you should have 60 ohms of resistance across pin C and D. That's letting us know that we have a terminating resistor of 120 ohms on each end of the bus for a total resistance of 60 ohms. Now, the best way to test this is going to be with the key switch off and the batteries disconnected. So now that we've made our voltage checks, let's turn the key switch off, disconnect our batteries, then we're going to go across pins C and D, check our resistance, and we're hoping for 60 ohms plus or minus 2. Now, typically when you disconnect the batteries, just disconnecting all the ground side is perfectly fine. You can disconnect the entire power side, but what we want to do is we want to make sure that there is not a module on this bus that's powered up. So you want to make sure that you're completely disconnecting power from the chassis, from the batteries. Now, once we've done that, we're going to take our multimeter and we're going to put it on that omega symbol because now we're checking resistance. And we're going to move our pins to terminal C and terminal D. Once we've done that, we're going to notice here that we are roughly 58.9 to 59 ohms of resistance. So that tells me that both terminating resistors on my bus are intact and they are connected, reading the correct resistance. Because remember, you have one 120 ohm on one side, one 120 ohm on the other, total circuit resistance of 60 ohms. Now, if you're having communication problems and you verified the resistance and voltage values on your 9-pin like we just discussed, then you should be able to communicate. This is likely going to indicate that you have an issue with your PC or communication between your PC and your communication device, such as your Nexus Link or your TXT or your JAW Test Link. So hopefully this little tip here was helpful for you. I know a lot of times in the field people struggle with communication. I'm going to do a two-part to this video, so come back and check us out in the coming months, because I'm going to show you one other tip that you can use or technique that's going to help you figure out, is it a communication problem with the truck, my communication device, or my PC. And also, one last time, just remember, if this is helpful to you, remember to subscribe, remember to press that like button, and please throw some comments down below on what you'd like to see next, or even if this was helpful to you. Until next time, thank you for joining us. We'll see you soon.